Hello everyone, it's Mrs. Miller. So today we are going to go over the first part of Romantic era music. So last time I talked to you, we talked about just the Romantic movement in general. And it's really important to understand that stuff before we get into the music stuff, because then it makes it a lot easier to get through the music stuff because you're like, oh yeah, Randrin. Anyway. So this is the first part of it. So just the notes that I put down there for you are not so much like the ones I usually do where you're filling in one blank at a time. I just gave you a big thing of information which you can either be writing down at home or you can just read off of there, but this is getting into more grown-up note style where you have to figure it out yourself. I believe in you. Okay, so let's go over this. So, main characteristics of romantic music. You have this freedom from form and design. So, remember we talked about no rules, no rules, no, like how we don't want to follow rules, so we're not going to follow, oh, well, it has to go this, 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 and this. Nope, we're just gonna do whatever we want. So, they kind of threw away all those old ways of putting things together, and we're like, let's find new ways to do it. It was more personal and emotional. Like we talked about how everything's about your feelings and about your experiences. And so, while I say that all sarcastically, it makes for really good music. So, works out. You have song-like melodies, so things that melodies that you could sing along with. I mean, obviously they might not have words, but they're the kind of melodies that you could sing along with instead of just like do, 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 do. As well as many chromatic harmonies in discourse. Now, what I mean by that, like here is a major scale. Lovely. Now, here's a chromatic scale. And you can even hear on my little piano app on my phone how when it's ringing, those notes kind of like they kind of crunch, right? Having those chromatic things in there and chords that don't necessarily sound really pretty, really they grab into your ear and make you go ooh, they had dramatic contrasts of dynamics in pitch, so it's how loud can we make it? How quiet can we make it? How high we can make it? How low we can make it? It's all about seeing how far apart we can get things and jumping between them. Because that, once again, that's another thing that really hits you hard. It sticks in your ear. You have really big orchestras, okay? This is not a time where we're going to be discreet and using small, restrained things. This is like, bigger's better, y'all! Like, we're gonna go all out. So it wasn't even just, it was both the number of instruments and the kinds of instruments. They started adding more and more kinds of instruments, plus they just started adding more of each kind of instrument. So you have these huge orchestras, okay? You have a wide variety of pieces. So you have something that's maybe a little single song. It's done. Versus someone who writes a 5-hour opera, which we will talk about them. And not just a 5-hour opera, but then like 5 5-hour operas. Okay? So you have from tiny to huge, okay? You have program music, music that tells a story. We're going to talk a lot about program music because I think it's awesome. So it's specifically meant to tell a story within the music. Okay. You have use of recurring themes. So you have little melodies and rhythms that come up and they keep showing up, and that tells you what's going on. That really plays into being able to tell a story, 'cause like you can tell when a certain character is there or when they're doing a specific thing. We'll get into more of that. You have great technical virtuosity. So this is the point where people are like, I wonder how fast I can play this. Someone's like, I can play it faster. Well, I can play something that's more difficult. Like, it became a huge contest to see who could be the best. And, oh boy, did they come up with some cool stuff. Nationalism was, again, a big thing. The whole idea of being really proud of your heritage. People going out and collecting folk songs from their cultural heritage and putting that into their work, which is really cool. I mean, and I have on here ternary form. We talked about that back in classical, but the idea of ABA, which you're like, Mrs. Miller, you said freedom from form and design, but you know what? Ternary form, the ABA form, is just like a good idea in life. I don't know. For music, it's just super satisfying. You hear the first part, and then it moves to something different, and you're like, ooh, something different. But like, for it to feel finished, you want to go back to the first part and be like, oh, yeah. So they had a lot of that ternary form in there, that A-B-A. A-B-A. Okay? So here, we'll move on, maybe. Here we go. So orchestra. Richer harmonies, more passionate melodies, greater use of chromaticism. Like I said, those half steps, those... Okay? It's just a really cool sound. So everything is more... let's get rid of this. Anyway. There we go. Increase in the size of the orchestra. So it's not just strings anymore. We have the wind instruments. We have multiples of the instruments. It's just, they're trying to see how many different things they can put in there and how big they can make it. You get the valves on the brass instruments, which gives it more flexibility. Like, if you remember back in, that'd be fourth grade, when I brought all the instruments in and we talked about how all the instruments worked, and the trombone, the way you made it lower was you actually made the tube longer, right? Well, the way that works with like a trumpet is instead of moving something to make it longer, when you press down a button, it lets air into a different area. So technically it's making the tube longer. And same thing with the different varieties of stuff. So you're making the tube longer and shorter by cutting off parts of it or opening them up. So that made things a lot easier to do a lot more complicated stuff. So that's when you're getting all these different kinds of things where you can do that virtuosic stuff, where you can do all the little notes and then you don't have to worry on just how fast your lips can go. That is really cool. You have woodwind chamber groups. They're like, why is it that we can only do string groups? Like, if you order a string quartet for your wedding or whatever, it's going to be two violins, a viola, and a cello. But these woodwind chamber groups, they're going to be all sorts of different kinds of woodwind instruments. A chamber group means it's a small group, so it's not like an orchestra, it's a small group. But you start getting some really interesting stuff there. We get some new instruments. You get the tuba, the piccolo, the English horn, the bass clarinet, the bassoon. Basically, they're saying, how high can we make instruments go, and how low can we make instruments go? I played bass clarinet in high school. I loved it. It's literally the same fingerings as clarinet. It's just bigger, which is why I was able to do it. Piccolo, it's the exact same as flute, but tiny. Tuba, you're using the same kind of fingerings as trumpet. It's just bigger. They want to have those extremes to see how many different things you can do, okay? They had a larger string section for a larger sound. So, you know, they're just going to have a bigger orchestra. They want it big. Okay. More varied percussion. So they're saying, hey, you know what? If you use this, it makes a really cool sound. So how I can put that in there? Or, oh, I could add this in there. Oh, I could add this in there. Stuff that maybe they wouldn't have thought of as instruments before, or not thought of as something that you could put with an orchestra. like something that they might have thought as a sound effect, but now it's like, oh, hey, we could use that in music. They start adding all of that in there. And then you have new combinations of instruments. They're like, well, we're not just going to put strings together. We're going to, you know, try a little bit of everything. What if we want to have a flute and a tuba and a violin? I don't personally know of any music written for flute, tuba, and violin. But you get my point. It's about finding new combinations of instruments, right? Okay, here we go. So, the German Lied. So it's a story song for solo voice and piano. So this is talking about, we're getting into this storytelling element, right? So what they do is they'd set a group of poems or a story together. Some terms that we need for this, we have strophic, which is the same music, but every verse the words change, and through composed, which means different music for each verse. If you think it like through composed, they go through the whole composition without repeating things. Strophic is like at Mass when we sing hymns and we sing the same music each time, but each verse we sing new words. That's strophic. Through composed, you go through the whole thing. It's all new the whole time. Okay. A lot of time when it's through composed, they had the voice, the words and the voice really like stick together. So they're really, really following the words more so that they, it gives it that kind of, variation. It gives you something to base it off of instead of just having to come up with something. You're like, okay, well, no, it's going to really fit this. And that's how it makes it new the whole time. Okay. So the piano is more than just accompaniment, is a partner to the voice. You know, if you play any instrument or you sing and you take lessons or whatever, you're going to be used to, okay, I'm doing this solo where I play this piece and then I have a piano playing with me. But the piano in that case is there to just be like backup, and it's all about the soloist. When it comes to German Lied, it's a duet between the piano and the singer. You need to have that piano. Okay. So you have Schubert. He wrote a lot of these. The Erkling, the Trout to Sylvia. Let's see here. Oh, I bet you. Here's some bits. You get to see my, my thing here. Here we go. So that's it doesn't have the singing part on it. That's an arrangement where it's for quintet, whatever. But you can hear that's the quintet plus the piano. So you have that, Sylvia, I think I have that in here. So, you know, there's that. Those are instrumental versions of the Trout and Sylvia. But the Erlking is the one I really want to focus on because it is like So cool. So we're gonna try this. I hope YouTube doesn't take it down because of this. And if it does, I'll have to redo it and I'll be really sad. But I'm gonna play this off of here so you can watch. I'm also gonna include a link to this in the packet I give you. But if you watch this, make sure the closed captions are on because it's in German and you wanna know what they're saying, right? So here we go. So, very scary. Ooh, some things I'll let you listen to it again on your own time. But some things that are really important in there, like when the sun is singing, or the son's character is singing, it's in a higher range. When the father is singing, it's in a low range. The Earl King is in, you know, the middle, so is the narrator. But if you also listen, you can hear the son and the father and the narrator, they're all in a minor mode because, you know, it's a creepy story. But the Elf King, the Earl King, he sings in a major mode, which means that, you know, he's trying to tell him, he's like, oh, come with me, it's gonna be happy. And then at the end, when he like loses his patience, he's like, no, you're coming with me, that's when it turns minor again, and he's like, oh no. It's just like when I read books aloud to the younger students and I do voices for them. It's not just, and Katie said this and the ogre said this, it's, and Katie said bah, 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 and the ogre said whoa, 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 whoa. That's what they're doing when they're writing the melodies, is they're making sure the melodies are high or low depending on who's singing, or they have different characteristics. And the other character that's there that you might not think about when you first do it is the horse, because if you listen to that in the piano, sounds like horse running. And without that, if you just listen to the vocal part without the piano, it's going to be completely different. You're not going to get that sense of urgency that they're riding through the forest and that they're desperately trying to get home before this evil thing gets them. So like I said, the piano and the voice, they're it's a duet. It's not just a voice that happens to have a piano. No, you need both, okay? So other composers in the style were Schumann, Brahms, Wolf, and Richard Strauss. In this presentation, I know in past history units, like I've gone into real depth for, I'd pick a couple composers and really give a lot of information. But there's just so many notable composers in this era, and if we're going to cover the kinds of music they covered, I'm just going to be like, yeah, these were the people. And if you want to look it up on your own time, good for you. But Schubert, he's the one who wrote all of those German Lied. Lots of people other did too, like Schumann, Brahms, all of them. It was a pretty popular thing to do. Okay, so music for piano. So we have some improvements that were made on the piano in the 19th century, because, you know, when we talked in the classical period, we finally got the piano. You know, that's not one you're going to get wrong on your test, where it's like, well, what did this person play? They played the piano. No, the piano's not invented yet. And finally, we have the piano. Okay. And now we get to the 19th century and we're like, hey, what are some things we could do to make it even better? Okay. So there's more notes. Instead of being a very limited range, they start adding more on the top, more on the bottom, you know, big. They make a metal frame in there instead of wood, which really lets it resonate, lets the sound waves go out more. And you have that sustaining pedal. It's just like when I'm playing my little thing here and the notes, like, drag out. And you hear how they run into each other. That's trying to be like a sustaining pedal where it lets the notes ring for a little while after. Okay. So, you have some of the most famous piano composers, of that time were Schubert, Mendelssohn, Chopin, Schumann, Liszt, and Brahms. Liszt, is definitely one, and Chopin too, are people who are like, oh my gosh, crazy trying to do the most possible. Let's see. I'm trying to decide whether I want to put this under the virtuoso thing or not. I think we'll do it this time. Okay, close this. And here we go. Just sit back and watch. Thank you. So, you can see what on earth. I really like that video because that's the real person playing it. Okay, that's really their fingers. I mean, the little dots that go up there is obviously computer generated, but the little dots let you really see what's going on where like you can see the melodies going wrong, or you could see how all you heard all that little chromatic stuff where it was like, and it just blows my mind to watch it, because it's like it starts off and you're like, oh yeah, that's kind of hard, and then you're like, oh, it's getting harder, and then no, it couldn't possibly get harder than that. No, it couldn't possibly get hard. And then it gets harder and harder and harder. And it's just like, you get done and you're just like, I didn't realize human beings could do that. Which was literally like the point of Liszt and Paganini. Paganini and Liszt were the two people who worked together to write that one. And both of them were big show-offs. And that shows in their music. So, let's see. Nope, we're not done yet. Sorry, we're not done yet. Okay. So at this point in time, a sonata is one instrument or a soloist with one accompanying instrument. So like, you know, violin with a piano playing with it. A sonata can also just be one instrument by themselves. As a violinist in college, I played a lot of Bach sonatas, and I know Bach isn't a romantic writer, but it was all unaccompanied music, so it was all written for just violin to play with it just itself. So it's still a sonata, even if it doesn't have backup. You have dances, such as waltz, you have a mazurka, you have a polonaise, you have all sorts of different things here. Let me pull up some examples for you. So you can hear, there's like so many kinds of dances, guys, like so many. I'm guessing you're gonna recognize this. Like, I almost guarantee you've all heard that somewhere. Okay, here's an example of a mazurka, a different kind of dance here. One thing I like about that one, I'll play a little bit more. Ah! Come back! Wait. Well, I guess we'll just go without my face, maybe. Let's see. Oh, I'm back. One of the things I like about the mazurka that I just played for you is it illustrates a bunch of different things, including how they really like the really louds to the really quiets, right? You could hear that go back and forth. In a lot of the dances, you're going to be in a 3 meter, which instead of being like B, B, bumblebee, stung a man upon his knee. That's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Versus 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That feel, you have on a lot of dances because that it makes you want to dance. Like, you have that heavy downbeat on the 1 and the 2, 3 are your time to get your feet ready for the next 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. It just moves the body, okay? So there's a lot of dances that are in that 3 meter, which, you know, are cool. Here, we'll listen to a little bit more here. You get the point here. Boop, boop. Okay, so we have an etude. So the whole point of an etude is not to sound like a pretty piece of music. Like, you're not going to sit down and be like, I'm going to listen to a whole recording of etudes. They're literally just there to make you better at doing a specific thing. It's like running laps or doing suicide drills for basketball, where, you know, you're not playing basketball when you're running suicides, but you need that skill of being able to go back and forth really fast. So you just practice that skill. Etudes are like suicides for instruments. So here's an etude. Let's see, where did I put it? Here we go. Now, this goes on for 3.5 minutes. And literally, it's just so that the violinist can practice going ba 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 in every possible way. Which is important, because that's the thing that shows up in a lot of music. But it's not something you're gonna, like, just sit and listen to, okay? That's enough of that, man. It's like listening to homework. Ah! So here we go. So now we have mood and character pieces. So an impromptu, which is supposed to sound like you're just making up as you go, right? Like it's impromptu. A romance, it's supposed to sound romantic. Song without words. We're having these really dramatic names, right? You have a nocturne, which is supposed to make you think of night. A ballad, like a ballad, like something you sing. An intermezzo, something in between. A rhapsody, you know the word rhapsody from Bohemian Rhapsody. So here's some examples here. Let's see. Here we go. Here's a nocturne for you. If you listen to that, you can hear like that idea of, it sounds kind of like a lullaby, like something you'd listen to at night. So they have all these different kinds of things where the names of them are really describing the kind of feel they're going for, right? Let's see what's next in here. We might be done. Yes, we are done for this presentation. It's already going to take me like 10 years to upload. Thank you for watching this with me. Hope you enjoy it. I hope to see you at school as soon as possible. Have fun. Bye. Maybe.